Good morning. My name is Amy Stewart Jagir, and I'd like to welcome you this morning here at Pilgrim Congregational Church. We're so glad that you have chosen to worship with us this morning. We are an open and affirming congregation of the United Church of Christ. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. If you're joining us for the first time, we'd like to extend an especially warm welcome to you, and we hope that you'll come back and worship with us often. There are welcome cards in your pews, so if there's something you'd like me to know, or if you would like to make yourself known if you're visiting, then there's a place to write information on the back of the card, and then you can drop it in the offering plate as it goes by later in the service. We also have some prayer cards, so if there's a joy or a concern you'd like us to lift up during the prayer time this morning, you can also fill this out and drop it in the offering plate when it goes by. I do have a couple of announcements today. Following worship, we will have a time of fellowship down in Monblo Hall, so you can exit this door and take a right, and right at the end of that hallway, we'll have some refreshments and some coffee and tea, so please join us for that. And also, we'd like to acknowledge that today is Father's Day. So we'd like to honor all fathers and father figures this morning by making sure that you receive one of these bookmarks. So if you haven't already received one, then please take one with you. I'm sure that one of the ushers will make sure. They probably already made sure everybody had one, but just in case. So we recognize that this day may not always be an easy one. It could be especially tender for some of us. And so I just want to say that we will acknowledge that during our prayer time a little bit later this morning. We do have another announcement, and I'm going to bring the microphone over to Karin because she has something she'd like to share with us.
Well, it took a rainy day yesterday for me to read my GBH guide, because otherwise I would have announced this Wednesday at our very worthwhile ONA meeting. And it's this Tuesday at 9 o'clock on GBH. You'll go back to what it was like in the early 60s when it came to people who were transgender or had other issues. And it's in a series called The American Experience. So I urge you all to have Channel 2 on Tuesday at 9 o'clock. No, that's night, PM. Oh, yeah.
Pretty soon, we will begin the stroll, the summer strolls, right out here in front of the church. And the first one will be July 5th. And we have a couple of more spots that need to be filled for volunteers for that evening. So there's a sign-up sheet down in Monblo Hall. I'm told that it's a really fun event. So it's just a place to be. So you're going to want to sign up and participate. So please do that for the first week. And then hopefully we'll have all the other spots filled as well. But that's coming up pretty quickly. So I'd like to invite us now, as you're able, to turn around and wave. Somebody told me that not everybody believes that people see you waving when you wave to the camera. They do. They really do. So I would like to invite everybody, as you're able, to please stand and wave to those joining us on live stream, the camera right underneath the clock there. And then please also greet one another by way of offering the peace. One more thing I'd like to share. You, before Matt begins our prelude, we are continuing to experiment with how things look at the beginning of worship. So we're just rolling with a new way today. So I know you're really good at that. So roll away.
Good morning, everybody. Please stand for our responsive reading for a call to worship. I will, of course, be the one, and you will be the all. We are being called to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. It isn't going to be easy. There are dangers out there. Some people are going to misunderstand.
Help us to be clear and faithful
in bringing the message of love and justice. Our opening hymn is number 495, called as Partners in Christ's Service. Continuing our worship service, we have a unison prayer opening. Oh, God of love, open our hearts this day to receive your word for us. We will hear of the disciples who are given the mandate to heal, to raise the dead, to proclaim the kingdom and the good news of God's redeeming love. We stand in that long line of those who are called. We are ready to work for you, that this bruised and broken world may be healed. Give us courage, compassion, and hope. Continuing our worship with a prayer of confession, another unison reading. Loving God, without your grace, we are like sheep without a shepherd. Sometimes we use our own power to harass others who are helpless. Forgive us, O Lord, and bring us home. Hear the good news of God's love. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven, loved, and free. Today's scripture lesson is from the book of Matthew, chapter 9, verse 35 through chapter 10, verse 23. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus. Simon the Canaan, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions. Do not take a road leading to Gentiles, and do not enter a Samaritan town, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those with a skin disease, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics or sandals or a staff, for laborers deserve their food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who in it is worthy and stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet as you leave that house or town. Truly, I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. I am sending you out like sheep into the midst of wolves, so be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of them, for they will hand you over to council and flog you in their synagogues. And you will be dragged before governors and kings because of me, as a testimony to them and the Gentiles. When they hand you over, do not worry about how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you at that time. For it is not you who will speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Sibling will betray sibling to death, and a father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all because of my name. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in this town, flee to the next. For truly I tell you, you will not have finished going through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. So ends this scripture reading. God bless these holy words.
Please pray with me. O gracious God, may the words of my lips and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. There is so much to celebrate this week. So today is Father's Day, as you know, but did you know that this holiday has roots in two early 20th century occasions? It was kind of a rhetorical question, but I wouldn't have minded a nod. These include a commemoration for fathers killed in the December 1907 explosion at a West Virginia coal company, and a 1910 celebration inspired by a Civil War veteran and widower who raised 6 children on his own on a farm in Washington State. But regardless of its origins, it's an opportunity for us to acknowledge and remember those fathers and father figures who have made a positive imprint on our lives and who helped guide us along life's path. Today, we're also celebrating our high school graduates. In particular, we have Lucy Maughan and her mom with us today. Welcome. This life transition that high school graduation represents is such a significant one, as it marks those first tentative steps forward into a world no longer defined entirely by one's childhood. Further, tomorrow is an only one-year-old federal holiday, Juneteenth. It's also called Emancipation Day or Freedom Day, symbolically marking the end of chattel slavery in the United States. President Lincoln issued the Emancipation Proclamation in 1863, but it only applied to enslaved people in the Confederacy, and its enforcement depended on the presence of Union troops. So those Union troops did not arrive in Galveston, Texas, which was one of the southernmost outposts of enslaved territory, until June 19th, 1865. By the way, that was 11 years after this church was established as an anti-slavery church. Wednesday this week will be the longest day of the year, marking the official start to the summer season here in the Northern Hemisphere, the summer solstice. It's also the last day of school here in Harwich. So I wonder, what do all of these celebrations also represent? Can you pick up on a theme at all? Well, they are moments, what I see as moments pregnant with possibility and with hope. So our gospel lesson from Matthew today describes a moment of transition as well. This part of the gospel is a crucial turning point, a shift from the ministry of Jesus to the more expansive ministry in which Jesus empowers, equips, and commissions his disciples. Jesus has been traveling about in cities and villages, reaching and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness, is what we read. What Jesus is doing is not just hypothetical or theoretical. He is proclaiming the kingdom in word and in deed. So I'd like to interject a bit about the word or the term kingdom. You notice there was no G in there. It's been adopted by many Christian communities as an alternative to the word kingdom. And this is in part a substitution because it reduces the patriarchal language found in biblical witness and often in our Christian tradition. Dom, or Dom, D-O-M, retains the centrality of the sovereignty of God in a realm that has no end. The kin, K-I-N, at the beginning, emphasizes the primary importance of relationship and beloved community in the reign of the Holy One on earth as it is in heaven. It also reduces the framework of violence often found in discussions of the coming and realization of God's realm, and replaces it with language of family, connection, and love. So back to the text. In verses 37 and 38, Jesus points out that the harvest is plentiful, but the workers or laborers are few. He then instructs the 12 to pray that God would provide more workers. He moves from himself doing the work of the kingdom to empowering them to be the workers. He commissions his followers to go and do the very work that he has been doing. Just as John the Baptizer's proclamation that the kingdom of heaven has come near is picked up and carried by Jesus, Jesus' work is picked up and carried on by the disciples. So a passing of the baton, if you will. Last summer, Bruce and I flew to Salt Lake City, Utah, where our eldest daughter, Laura, had been living and working for 3 years. She would be moving to St. Louis, Missouri, to begin her one-year accelerated Master of Social Work program at Washington University. So we rented a U-Haul truck to move her. During the trip, we drove just about 1,500 miles. One-third of that trip was across the entire state of Nebraska. Do you know what we saw along the entire route of the state of Nebraska? Yes, Route 80 goes about 500 miles through that state, and we saw almost entirely that one thing, corn. They call it the Cornhusker State for a reason. Mile after mile after mile of cornfields. And I can just imagine what it would have been like to try to harvest all that corn without enough people or also enough equipment to get the job done. It would be an impossible task. Of course, corn would not have been the crop growing in first century Palestine, but nevertheless, the image of bringing in a plentiful harvest reminds me of those Nebraska cornfields. So when Jesus charges and empowers and entrusts these apostles, he does so acknowledging the plentiful harvest that is the work for them to do, signifying that there is a lot of it, and that it requires more than just one person to do it. Of course, he really isn't talking about farming. He's talking about the work of discipleship. So you may recall that discipleship has been a bit of a theme for us these last couple of weeks. Last week, Lauren addressed the intertwining of leading and following. The week before, on Trinity Sunday, I talked about discipleship not being a destination, but rather a lifelong journey, and a challenging one at that. Discipleship, we know, is a commitment, and it often requires sacrifice. So I suppose that's what Jesus is talking about when he emphasizes to these apostles some of the challenges they can expect along the way. He almost sounds like a commanding officer sending troops out to battle. Jesus instructs them on actions and behaviors they will need to realize, well, what it will take for them to realize the kingdom in tangible and immediate ways. He doesn't sugarcoat anything either. He outlines just what a commitment and sacrifice the work of discipleship will be. So what is this work of discipleship, of kingdom building? The labor Jesus describes is that of proclaiming good news and bringing healing and renewal to all, wholeness. And that God's grace and presence is available to all. So how does that happen? Well, in part it happens because Jesus calls together these 12 men. He calls them by name. Indeed, a most motley crew. Let's think about the roster. First is Peter, who we know will deny Jesus explicitly when Jesus is arrested. Last comes Judas, the betrayer himself. And in between are some uneducated, unremarkable fishermen. In first century Palestine, fishermen were essentially at the bottom of the social hierarchy. Then we have Matthew, the tax collector. This was a despised profession, since so often tax collectors were corrupt collaborators with the Roman occupiers. And then we had Simon the Cananean, who was also known as the Zealot. He battled against the Roman occupiers. So what an unlikely assembly of men. What do they have in common? They are called by Jesus to labor together. Through our scripture text, we see that this dealing with the disciples, the 12 disciples, and it's dealing with Jesus and his 12 disciples specifically and their mission, but it's also instructive for the entire church and us today. So how do we participate in God's kingdom? What is the harvest that needs tending and care in our time? And how do we mitigate all those challenges that Jesus outlined? Well, there are three things I'd like to highlight for us. I propose that we must enter into the labor of discipleship, the kingdom building, with intention, with compassion, and with prayer. And in order to mitigate the challenges, we must travel light. First, let's talk about intention. Beginning with the end in mind is an excellent principle to guide our years, our days, our life. As followers in the way of Jesus, as Christians, we are called to first be aware of how God's love and grace is present in our lives. It doesn't mean we need to go around converting people to Christianity. It does mean that we can walk the walk, not just talk the talk. We can do this by setting an intention to live in such a way as to express the joy and gratitude for grace and blessings that we receive from God and to share those things. A former colleague of mine gifted me with this little message made of wood. And if you can't see it, it says, "Wake up and be awesome." So I have this hanging right by my bathroom mirror, so it's one of the first things that I see when I wake up in the morning, and it serves as a daily reminder to be intentional about how I use the gift of each new day. Next, compassion. We read in Matthew 9, verse 36, that when he, Jesus, saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. This predicament moves Jesus with compassion. He leads with and acts with compassion in several ways. First, he recognizes that many of us can't help but allow life circumstances to determine our frame of mind. Sometimes it's difficult for us to have eyes to see beyond our circumstances. We often allow ourselves to be bent over, clenched up, and harassed. When this is the perspective from which we view our lives, of course we feel helpless. Jesus, though, meets us where we are and does so with concern for our distress and suffering. He doesn't judge us. Instead, he has a desire to alleviate those things in whatever way he is able. And we can do the same. Meeting people in their distress and suffering with a desire to help can be on a grand scale. For example, addressing systems of oppression. It can also mean small actions of kindness and caring as well. It can also simply mean showing up and listening. It can mean welcome and acceptance. Thirdly, let's talk a little bit about prayer. Once we experience God's grace, we want others to experience it as well. It makes me think of that song, "It Only Takes a Spark to Get a Fire Going." So we see that the whole world is in need of God's grace, like fields ready to be harvested. So Jesus tells us to pray that God will send workers into the fields. And in today's text, this call to prayer is followed by the commissioning of the 12. They are sent out to extend the ministry they have witnessed Jesus performing. And they are being sent out to help supply God's answer to the prayer Jesus told them to pray. They themselves were the answer to prayer. We know that it can take a toll maintaining levels of compassion for the labor of ministry. And Jesus modeled for us how to do this. There are many times when he went off alone to pray. Going back to the source of compassion, dipping into that deep well for restoration for ourselves is important. Prayer and other spiritual practices are essential to a life of discipleship. And so I wonder, what are the ways that you and I get back to a sense of balance, a sense of wholeness? That's a source to tap into. Finally, I think that this passage invites us to travel light. Part of that is recognizing that not everyone is willing or open to receiving God's gifts at any particular time. Sometimes our work for God will produce opposition. Jesus sends us out warning us that being part of God's mission can bring obstacles and sometimes even dangers. He talks of religious and civic opposition. He warns of personal betrayals. Not everyone is going to thank us or agree with what we believe or what we are doing. So we are to stay true to the mission, not the circumstances we encounter along the way. We may need to set our course in a new direction, trusting God's grace and knowing that nothing will separate us from God's love. The most important point, though, is that we do not do this work alone. Look around. We do not do this work alone. Jesus encourages us in joining this mission through his instructions to the disciples. Jesus sets an urgent tone, instructing the disciples to essentially travel lightly. And I believe Jesus is teaching us to go forward, trusting in God's grace. Trust that that same grace that first brought us to Jesus in the first place will be with us as we join God's mission. After all, God's grace is not a one-time experience, but a lifelong journey. Jesus asks us to make that journey in service to others and with others, so that we and they may know the joy of God's gifts in our lives, and that they would know God's gifts in their lives as well. May it be so.
Thank you.
seated. I'd like to invite Beverly and Heidi and Lucy to come forward, please. It's a very special day to be able to honor and recognize Lucy as our scholarship recipient this morning.
Hi, Lucy. I think the first time I saw you, you were about 5 years old, and you were just kind of crawling around down here, and you were always moving, always darting around, and that's how I remember seeing you all the time. You were full of joy and light. During your next few years, the teachers of the Sunday school made these lovely stars construction paper and put Sunday school children's names on these. And they were randomly picked out by the congregation to pray for these children. And there was many in the congregation that actually picked your name too, and I was one of them. So I always prayed for you. And I would tell your mother, I'm praying for Amy. Lucy. Amy's the other one. Yeah. Amy, I'm praying for Lucy. And she'd say, that's good because she needs it. I think your parents needed it too, probably. But it's a delight to be able to have you here and see how you've matured and grown and what goes on in the next few years of your life. And we God bless you. And Pilgrim Church will still be praying for you.
So Lucy, we have a card and a check. So congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Yes.
Thank you.
And the funds, just to say, the funds come from two different sources, through a restricted fund that we have at the church for scholarships, as well as a restricted fund through the Pilgrim Women's Fellowship. So that's why Beverly and I are up here today. So congratulations, and we wish you the best at St. Anselm.
Thank you guys so much.
One more thing. The church also has one other gift for you. It's a book, and it's a book that's entitled Freshman Survival Guide. This is an excellent book. It covers lots of different areas, and the one that stands out to me the most is to be generous with your friendship, stingy with your trust. It's a really bit of, I think, wisdom that will carry you through this upcoming year and beyond. So I wish you all the best, and
thank
I wish
so
I'd gotten
much.
To know you, but I wish you all
thank
the best.
Thank you so much.
Thank
you. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Take care.
Well, the past few years have been really a lot, very interesting. First, we had COVID, and then we couldn't get any toilet paper. And now you can get most everything, but trying to pay for it is a challenge in itself. We've had interesting economic times, and if you're like me, you go to the store and you find that the price of everything has gone up and the quantity that you get has gone down. And every day, I'm deluged by requests for people for money. Some of them are probably very legitimate. Some of them may be questionable. Myself, I don't have the time or the inclination to try to research any of these people who want cash from me. But what I've decided to do, and as a family, we give to the proven winners. We give to charities that we've known for years, that we know do good work. And above all, we give to the church. Because I know who manages the church, I know what the church does, and I know we do all of our good here in the community. So I'd advise you to go for a proven winner and support your church. The morning offering will now be received.
Let us pray as we dedicate these offerings received. Good and holy God, for your steadfast love and faithfulness, we give you thanks and bless your name. Let our whole lives become songs of gratitude and joy and praise, so that all the earth may know that we are your people and you are our God. May you bless these gifts and the givers alike, so that your kingdom work continues here in this place. Amen. You may be seated. So I'd like to share, before we begin the prayer, share some of the prayer requests that have come forward. I have my glasses just in case. For the joy of 56 years of wedded bliss for Bonnie and Ross Hall. Aww. I'm pretty sure we have another anniversary this week too, right? Gil and Joan Stone, 60 years? 60 years. Bud? 54 for Bud and Midge Day this week too? A popular wedding week. Yes. Bruce Jaguar and Amy Jaguar are celebrating 30 tomorrow. You guys too? 61 years. Pretty quick with math and you can add up all those years of marriage. That's a lot. That's a lot. Congratulations, everyone. Also some prayers for John, Tom, Beth, John, Tim, Jack, Joanne, and Dave for safe and happy travel, for Sharon fighting cancer, for the family of Priscilla Hughes, whose sister, is it her daughter? Her daughter. Okay, so the family of Priscilla Hughes, whose daughter Corinne also died this week. Yeah, that's just 2 weeks after her mom. Alex, who is preparing for a clinical trial at Massachusetts General Hospital. For Anne and John, for a safe journey. For Kathleen and Dee Dee, the family of Mike, and the family of Priscilla Hughes. For Rose Marie. This one says, Happy Father's Day to God. We like to include prayers for fathers and father figures, for those who have had or continue to have complicated relationships with their fathers and father figures, those whose fathers have passed from this earthly realm. For the celebration of Juneteenth and the continued work of anti-racism in ourselves, our communities, and our institutions. For the celebration of Pride Month and all who identify as LGBTQ+ and their allies, and that our congregation will intentionally provide not just welcome, but safety and compassion. For Lucy and her classmates who have graduated from high school and will transition to a new stage of life. And for students, teachers, and other school staff and bus drivers during this last week of the school year, let us pray. From you alone, Lord Jesus Christ, comes authority to heal the sick, to cast out demons, welcome the outcast, and even raise the dead. Therefore, we are bold to seek your power and ready to claim your grace. Touch us with compassion, Holy One, and touch all who suffer. Speak the word that will make them whole. Banish the powers that oppress your people. Bring peace to troubled hearts and minds. Open the doors of your church and of this church in particular to all. Gather the lost and bring them home. As you broke free from the grave, destroy the power of death forever. We thank you, O God, that you hear our spoken prayers, but sometimes, there are prayers which reside only deep within us. And so, O God, we pause in silence now and offer those prayers which are perhaps too fragile for the spoken word. Nothing is impossible for you, Christ Jesus. Let these signs of your coming realm be manifest in our world today, for you are our Lord and Savior. And we offer back to you now the prayer you taught your disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. May the love of God and the grace of Christ and the Spirit's peace be with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen and amen.